हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, होप यू ऑल आर वेल एट होम एंड डूइंग हार्ड वर्क टू अचीव द गोल्स. स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम बैक टू द इकोनॉमिक्स क्लास ऑफ प्लस वन स्टैंडर्ड. टुडे वी विल स्टार्ट विथ न्यू चैप्टर, लेसन नंबर 5, इंट्रोडक्शन टू इंडियन इकोनॉमिक डेवलपमेंट. इन दिस वी विल डिस्कस द टॉपिक्स, व्हाट इज इंडियन इकोनॉमी, फीचर्स ऑफ द इंडियन इकोनॉमी एट द टाइम ऑफ इंडिपेंडेंस, स्टेट ऑफ मेजर इकोनॉमिक सेक्टर्स, एग्रीकल्चर, इंडस्ट्री एंड फॉरन ट्रेड. So let's start with the introduction first. British rule that started with the conquest of Plassey Battle in 1757 lasted for about 200 years. It has its far-reaching consequences. New land system of British ruler created a serious impact on the Indian economy. Gradual decay of Indian handicrafts, unemployed craftsmen and artisans couldn't find any alternative occupation. British rule converted our prosperous economy into backward, stagnant, depleted, and disintegrated economy. The sole purpose of the British colonial rule in India was to introduce it into a feeder economy for Great Britain's own rapidly expanding industries. What is Indian economy? Let's discuss. The economy of India is characterized as a developing market economy. It is world's fifth largest economy by nominal GDP and third largest by purchasing power parity. India's per capita income ranked 139th by the GDP according to IMF. IMF means International Monetary Fund. Indian economy consists of all production units or institutions such as factories, farms, mines, shops, workshops, hospitals, railways, banks, offices, schools, colleges, universities, companies, industries, etc., which provide employment to its people on one hand and produce variety of goods and services required by them. Before independence, people themselves decided about what goods to be produced, how much to be produced, and who will consume them. But after independence, government of India had and state government have been started taking interest in working of the economy. In the Indian economy, there are three sectors: primary sector, secondary sector or manufacturing sector, and tertiary sector. Under the primary sector, farming, poultry, sheep rearing, forestry, fishery, etc. are there. Under the secondary or the manufacturing sector, heavy manufacturing, light manufacturing, food processing, oil refining, energy production, etc. services are there. In the tertiary sector, which is also known as service sector, banking, insurance, transport, shipping, communication, trade, interest, all these activities are there. The relative importance of these sectors to the country's national income on the eve of independence was: primary sector contribution to the GDP of India was 58.7%, secondary sector 14.3%, and tertiary sector contribution was 27%. Maximum contribution to the GDP by the primary sector on the eve of independence was there. Now, next one is features of Indian economy at the time of independence. First of all, we will see some pictures and key terms also related to the topic. First one is economy. What is the meaning of economy? An area of the production, distribution and trade as well as consumption of goods and services by different agents like individuals, businessmen, governments. So a given economy is the result of a set of processes that involves its culture, values, education, technological evolution, history, social organization, political structure and legal systems, as well as its geography, natural resources, endowment and ecology as main factors. That is known as economy. Next one is non-economic activities, like children playing football for entertainment, nursing of a baby by a mother, singing for self-entertainment are all non-economic activities. So non-economic activities is an activity performed gladly with the aim of providing services to others without any regard to the monetary gain. So those human activities which are undertaken for personal satisfaction or to satisfy human sentiments are non-economic activities. Next one is economic activities, like work done by the carpenter, laborers, weavers, advocate, teachers, doctors are all economic activities. So economic activities is the activity of making, providing, purchasing or selling goods or services. Any action that involves producing, distribution or consuming products or services is an economic activity. Any activities involving money or the exchange of products or services are economic activities. Next one is colonialism. What is the meaning of colonialism? Colonialism refers to a system of political and social relation between two countries, of which one is the ruler and other is its colony. The ruling country not only has political control over the colony, but it also determines the economic policies of the dominated country. In case of India, unequal relationship between the colony, that is India, and the ruling country, that is Britain, resulted in underdevelopment of India. Next one is tenants. A person who occupies land on rent, that is known as tenants, and cultivate the land. Now peasants, a poor smallholders or the agricultural laborers of low status, that is known as the peasants. Now next one is Indian economy on the eve of independence. Topics to be covered under this topic, that is low level of economic development under the colonial rule, agricultural sector, industrial sector, foreign trade, demographic condition, occupational structure and infrastructure. Indian economy on the eve of independence having low level of economic development, these are the features: backward agriculture sector, developed industrial sector, low foreign trade, adverse demographic condition, underdeveloped infrastructure and more dependency on the private sector occupation structure due to the decaying of the handicraft industry. Next one is see the condition of Indian agriculture on the eve of independence. Old methods for plowing fields are used. No new technology it is there. Spraying of fertilizers with hands. The primary objective of the British colonial rule in India was to turn India as supplier of the raw material and as a consumer of finished goods. Next one is under this system, under the British rule, zamindari system was also introduced. The main work of the zamindar was to collect the taxes from the tenants and the cultivators, and after keeping the part of its money, left part it will be deposited to the government. At the time of the British rule, the industrial sector was also not developed. Next one is handicraft industry was also decaying during the colonial rule. Due to the discriminatory tariff policy and finished goods from Britain were low priced and our products are of higher prices, that why there is a lesser demand in the economy. See the handicraft industries in India: doll making, basket making, designing. Due to the decaying of the handicraft industry, most of the population dependent on the agriculture sector, and mass poverty, malnutrition, ill health was the problems that were faced by the Indian economy. Occupational structure during the colonial rule was this one, that agriculture sector's contribution to the national income, that is 70 to 75%, and by the manufacturing sector, that is 10%, and by the service sector, that is 15 to 20% contribution was there into the national income. Now the development of the railways during the British rule, it was beneficial to the Indian economy little bit. But so now next one is features of Indian economy at the time of independence. First one is semi-feudal economy, feudalism and capitalism. Feudalism means existence of middlemen between the actual cultivators and the government. In agriculture, permanent or the temporary zamindar system settlement was there. peasants lost their ownership rights on land. Zamindars collect land revenue from the farmers and deposit it to the government by keeping a part of it with them. In the absence of any restraint on the zamindars, the land rents fixed under this system were excessive. Demand for land was increasing because of population pressure increased due to the decline of handicraft sector. Next one is, landlords could therefore charge higher rents and thereby exploit the cultivators. In some part of the country, there existed another system of land tenure, namely riotwari system. Under this system, the landowner was directly responsible to the government for the payment of land revenue. Next one is capitalism, an economic and political system in which a country's trade and country controlled by the private owner. Capitalistic countries like USA, Japan, China are all the examples of capitalism. Now, in the middle of 19th century, the growing trends towards the market economy had also helped in the development of the Indian capitalistic sector. Many capitalistic industries set up like cotton textile, jute, iron, steel, sugar and paper mills, etc. Most of these industries were in large amount of foreign capital was invented and managed by the foreign managing agents. These managing agents offered their services for the management of the firms owned by others. They used to charge substantial remuneration for their services. At the time of the agriculture sector of the economy, tea, coffee and rubber plantations were capitalistic enterprises which engaged a large number of workers. Next one is stagnant economy. During the British rule, Indian economy was growing at a very slow rate. No efforts by the Britishers to estimate India's national income or per capita income. Per capita income measures the average income earned by persons in a given area or in a specified year. Per capita income, it is equals to the national income divided by the population size. The first estimate of national income was provided by Dadabhai Naroji in 1867-68. National income was equals to rupees 340 crore and per capita income was equals to rupees 20 per annum. William Digby, Findlay, Shiraz, VKRV Rao and R.C. Desai also estimate the national income. Studies suggest that the country's growth of real output during the first half of the 20th century was 2%. Agriculture output was also increased only by 10% during 52 years period of 1893 till 94 to 1945 till 46. Thus, Indian economy was stagnant during British rule. Backward economy or underdeveloped economy. At the time of colonial period, Indian economy was underdeveloped economy. Its per capita income and living standard was very low. Industrial and agriculture sector were backward. Evidence of underdeveloped economy. Aggregate real output during the first half of the 20th century was less than 2%. Growth of per capita income per year. Mass illiteracy and high birth rate and death rates are there due to the lack of the medical and health facilities, malnutrition, lack of the nutritious food, education, etc. So during British rule, India remained a country of villages. 6 out of 7 persons were living in villages without modern facilities. Higher the urbanization, higher is the economic development. This was the thinking. But in India, only 14.2% population used to live in towns. Country was dependent on foreign countries for plant and machinery needed for the economic development. Import of defense goods was also import from the other countries. Indian economy at the time of independence was rural and agriculture in character. 72% of population engaged in agriculture. Country was not self-sufficient, even for food items also. Britishers didn't pay any attention towards the development of irrigation facilities. Farmers were the sufferers due to the drought, floods and famines. Industrial development of India was totally unbalanced. industrial development took place around Kolkata and Mumbai. Basic and capital goods industries were neglected. Tata Iron and the steel company was the only basic industry at that time, which was established in 1907. Main cause of the backwardness and stagnation. First one is land tenure system. The main cause of backwardness and the stagnation of the Indian economy was the first cause is land tenure system. Land taxes collected by the zamindars and very little was left with farmers. So development was impossible. Colonial government and the zamindars didn't do anything to improve the conditions of the agriculture. Their main motive was only to collect the rent. Second cause was for the stagnation, that is discriminatory industrial and commercial policies. The colonial government adopted the policy of deindustrialization in India. It had twofold objectives. First one is the government wanted India to supply important raw material for the upcoming industries in England. Second, to ensure their continuous expansion. The British rulers wanted to turn India into the large market for the products of those industries. So the objective of the British rulers was to transform the Indian economy into a complementary economy of England. Next one is drain of wealth. In the 19th century, certain expenditures in sterling were incurred by the Indian government in England, which were called home charges. The expenditures included dividends to shareholders of East India Company, interest on loan raised by the government of India in England, price of stores bought in England on behalf of India, expenditure on the British Army stationed in India, etc. Next one cause was colonial trade policy. Britishers having monopoly control over India's foreign trade. Monopoly means single seller. A significant reduction in the transport cost due to the opening of Suez Canal in 1869, which served as a direct route between India and Britain, promoted monopoly control of India's foreign trade by the British government. Depleted economy. India was a depleted economy as there were no engineering and capital goods industries. Second World War was also depreciated the Indian economy. In order to meet war requirements, Indian industry had to work day and night. Thus, there was a heavy loss of plant and machinery. Depreciation was there in terms of wear and tear. Their replacements were not available. Spare parts were not available. Therefore, country had only few capital and engineering good industries. So import was also not feasible. Stock of raw material was also declined. Dependent economy. Before the start of the British rule, India was a self-reliant economy. It had self-sufficient village communities. Agriculture used to meet the basic requirements of food, fodder, and fuel. Production was only for self-consumption. Economy was well known for its handicraft industry. In the field of cotton and textile mills, metal and precious stones work, etc. Products were worldwide famous. Britishers transformed our economy into a supplier of raw material and importers of consumer goods from England. Resulted pressure on agriculture land increased and this lowers the agriculture productivity and import of food. Disintegrated economy. Britishers divide India into two parts, India and Pakistan. 77% of the territory and nearly 82% of the population of undivided India were left in India. Rest went to Pakistan. This partition adversely affect the Indian economy. Next one is problem of rehabilitation. Due to division, large scale of movement of people gave rise to a serious problem of rehabilitation of millions of refugees from Pakistan and put a heavy burden on Indian economy. Next one is shortage of raw material. Most of the cotton and jute growing areas went to Pakistan, whereas the cotton and jute mills remained with India. So this created a shortage of raw material. That was a great problem. Jute mills of Kolkata couldn't get the jute of West Bengal. Cotton mills of Bombay and Ahmedabad had to go without the raw cotton of West Punjab and Sindh. Now it is in Pakistan. Food shortage. The problem of food shortage began to felt in 1937 when Burma, that is a rice producing area, was separated from India. The partition of 1947 made this problem more serious. The food surplus area of West Punjab and Sindh went to Pakistan. Food deficit in India was about 30 lakh tons per year, and in Pakistan there was a surplus of food, that is 7.5 lakh tons per year. Next one is loss of markets. Due to partition, some of our industries lost their markets also. The areas which went to Pakistan used to make demand for the large quantities of cotton textile, glass, soap, vegetables, vegetable oil, rubber goods, etc. Due to partition, there is fall in demand for these goods and a serious setback to the industries. Next one is dislocation of transport and communication facilities. The railway network of undivided India was also disrupted by partition. The Indian Union obtained 39,300 km out of the total railway length of 50,100 km. The entire railway system of the border area had to be performed, which involved a huge burden on the Indian economy. Indian economy was already suffering from mass poverty and backwardness and was further shaken by the partition. So, hope students, you all have understood the topic. In this, we have discussed today the features of the Indian economy on the eve of independence, agriculture, industry, and foreign trade. And now the time to note down the homework. Note down the homework. Question number first is, what is Indian economy? Second question is, discuss the features of Indian economy at the time of independence. Third question is, discuss the main causes of backwardness and stagnation of Indian economy. And students, please go through the links on the YouTube for more clarity. Thank you for listening.